Hey everyone, this lesson is on vitamin B12 deficiency. So in this lesson, we're going to talk about the signs and symptoms of vitamin B12 deficiency. We're also going to talk about why we get those particular signs and symptoms. And we're also going to talk about laboratory investigations to make the diagnosis and what we can do to treat it. So vitamin B12 is acquired from our diet, and generally it's from animal products. So if we have a vitamin B12 deficiency, either through reduced dietary intake of vitamin B12 or through one of many different compromised absorption processes, either through use of certain medications, certain disease processes, or autoimmune conditions, or even a fish tapeworm. If you haven't already, please check out my lesson on causes of vitamin B12 deficiency. So vitamin B12 is so important because it's required for the production and health of red blood cells and also the health of the central nervous system. We're going to talk about why that is and what happens when we don't have enough vitamin B12 in our bodies. Vitamin B12 is required for two specific and very important enzymes within our body. And there's one enzyme in particular I want to talk about in this lesson that I want you to remember. So generally when we ingest the amino acid methionine, methionine gets converted to methylmalonyl-CoA. Methylmalonyl-CoA gets acted on by the enzyme methylmalonyl-CoA mutase. And this is the enzyme that actually requires vitamin B12. And what this enzyme does is it converts methylmalonyl-CoA to succinyl-CoA. So without vitamin B12, we have no activation, no action of this enzyme. What that means is that anything before that is going to be backed up. And what happens is methylmalonyl-CoA increases in concentrations. And when that happens, it gets converted to methylmalonic acid. Now, methylmalonic acid is the problem here. This methylmalonic acid will eventually continue to increase in concentration and will lead to axonal neuropathy. So it starts to damage neurons. And it does so in a specific part of the central nervous system, the dorsal column medial lemniscus system, DCMLS. So this is what I want you to really take away from this. Because we don't have any vitamin B12, we're going to have issues with using methylmalonyl-CoA mutase. It's going to lead to backing up of methylmalonyl-CoA, an increased concentration of methylmalonic acid, which eventually leads to damage to neurons. So it leads to axonal neuropathy in the dorsal column medial lemniscus system. So this leads into the clinical presentation of B12 deficiency. You get irreversible neurological symptoms from prolonged B12 deficiency because of the axonal neuropathy. So again, axonal neuropathy within the dorsal column medial lemniscus system, DCMLS, you're going to get damage to those neurons. Those neurons are not going to come back. They're not going to be repaired. So what you're going to get is you're going to have issues with two-point discrimination, proprioception, and vibratory sense. You're going to have symmetric paresthesias and a shuffling gait. They feel unsteady on their feet. They're not able to walk well because they just don't have that proprioception. So if B12 deficiency lasts and is prolonged, it can lead to irreversible symptoms such as these. There are also some possibly reversible neurologic and psychiatric symptoms. Depression, irritability, insomnia, forgetfulness, all of these things can be things where if someone comes in with some psychiatric symptoms, just out of the blue. Sometimes it's a good practice to actually check a B12 level just to see, you know, maybe they are just low in B12 and some of these symptoms could just be caused by the B12 deficiency. B12 deficiency also leads to a megaloblastic macrocytic anemia. So what does that mean? If you haven't already checked out my anemia lesson, please check out that lesson for a good overview of anemia. But macrocytic anemia means that the MCV of a red blood cell is generally greater than 100, and megaloblastic means that there's impaired DNA synthesis. And specifically that when we look at neutrophils or white blood cells, they're hypersegmented, and there's about 5 or more lobes in the neutrophils. So you can see in this image here, we're seeing more than 5 of these lobes, so it's hypersegmented. It is megaloblastic. And you're also going to get symptoms of anemia. So there's many symptoms of anemia. It could be shortness of breath, pallor, fatigue. All those types of signs and symptoms of anemia are important to look out for as well. So how do we make the diagnosis and how do we treat B12 deficiency? The diagnosis of B12 includes looking at a B12 level. So we're going to see low B12 level. That's pretty easy. But we can also look at methylmalonic acid levels. And again, we're going to see elevated levels of methylmalonic acid. Now, this may come up, and I just want to quickly touch on this, but sometimes you may come across homocysteine. Now, homocysteine can be elevated in B12 deficiency, but it's also elevated in folate deficiency. So it's not a good marker to look at when making the diagnosis. Methylmalonic acid is the one you always want to check, even when you're thinking of a folate deficiency. So again, methylmalonic acid is going to be elevated in B12 deficiency and actually normal in folate deficiency. And we can also use the Schilling's test. You're not going to use the Schilling's test, but it's something that's good to know about. The Schilling's test, there's a few steps. The first one is you're going to give an IM injection of B12, so you're going to saturate the B12 within someone's body. You're going to give oral B12, and then you're going to check their urine. And if their urine is positive for B12, the original problem was nutritional. So if you think about it, the first thing was an IM injection of B12. It saturates all the B12 within their body. If we give oral B12, they're just going to pee it out. So if they're absorbing it well through the oral route, they're going to just pee it out because they're just already saturated in B12. So that's where you're going to get, you're going to find that if you see it in the urine, it was a nutritional problem. But if you don't see it in the urine, it was impaired absorption. So again, if B12's already been saturated through that IM injection, you give oral B12 and you're not seeing them pee it out, well, that leads you to believe that they didn't actually absorb that oral B12 that you just gave them. So that is the basis of the Schilling's test. So it's just something to know about. Generally, you're not going to do it. And treatment of B12 deficiency depends on whether it was due to impaired absorption or nutritional deficiency. If it's impaired absorption, you're going to probably give it by IM injection of B12. If it was a nutritional deficiency, you may just be able to get away with just giving them oral B12 supplements. So you can kind of distinguish that from the history, and if it's on a test, maybe the Schilling's test. And I just want to quickly talk about some dietary options. We talked about B12 coming from animal products, but two specific foods with extremely high levels of B12 are clams and liver. And it makes sense, right? Liver is the place where vitamin B12 is stored within our body, so it's going to have high levels of B12. So these are the two main foods that have extremely high levels of vitamin B12, and other animal products also have vitamin B12 as well, but I just wanted to quickly mention that. So if you haven't already, please check out my vitamin B12 lesson on metabolism and absorption, because it gives some more detail, some more information on the process in general. And if you haven't already, please consider liking, subscribing, and clicking the notification bell to help support this channel. And thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you next time.